So
welcome to Goddess Talk with Balaji. Today is a beautiful day because I have a wonderful guest here with us, Miss Natasha Pierre. Hi, Natasha. How are you?
Hi.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you for signing up. Natasha, I'm just getting into it because our energy is just in love right now. But you were one of the first people that I sent the link out when we were really starting the show. And I was like, I knew exactly who I wanted on this show. And you've always been in the mental health that I've seen on Facebook. Me and you met 2 years ago, and that was our first and only interaction. It's been 2 years. And I was like, no, I want her on there because she does this all day, all online. I just see her talk about mental health and different things and spirituality and stuff. So you were one of the first ones that I sent that link to, and you booked right away. So you are really like, thank you so much for booking with Goddess Talk.
Welcome.
Yeah. So we're going to get into it. Miss Natasha Pierre, your credentials are just amazing. So I'm just going to read the first part because I want people to understand who you are and what you're about, okay? So Natasha Pierre is an award-winning speaker, author, certified professional life coach, and a mental health advocate with over 20 years of lived experience. Lived experience. Make sure y'all pay attention to that. Her relatable speaking style allows her to connect with the global audience to share the importance of self-awareness, self-advocacy, community building, and effective legislation. There's a lot more to it. But the fact that you have lived experience, okay, but then you have work experience. A lot of people don't understand the two, the difference between the two. But, you know, tell us a little bit more about you, you know, whatever you're willing to share about what it is working within this field of mental health, because you are a certified life coach and also certified what?
I've got a lot of certifications. A lot of certifications, mm-hmm. A lot of credentials. But when I am
move closer.
There I am. When I'm speaking about mental health, mm-hmm. The only thing for me that's important is that I have lived experience.
Mm-hmm.
All of the other credentials and certifications are for people who are impressed by that.
Mm.
And for other academics and clinicians who want to understand why I have a seat at the table.
Mm-hmm.
But for people who are living with any mental health diagnosis,
mm-hmm.
all they want to know is that there's someone speaking to them and for them that understands.
Yes.
There's a difference between having a textbook understanding of depression and actually laying in the bed for 5 hours pressing snooze every 8 minutes because you literally cannot get out of bed.
Okay. And within our community, I think we want to really touch on that, mm-hmm. because a lot of us have been misdiagnosed, overdiagnosed, all that, you know. So there are some people who truly have mental illnesses that do need help. But then there's people who are being diagnosed with something that have none of those. It's just, you know, the school system. And we know the prison to the school to prison pipeline. So we see both sides. So what have you experienced with, have you experienced people who've been misdiagnosed? I'm sure you probably have.
Absolutely. I think in our society, what I'm seeing a lot of is mental health diagnoses being given to people who are experiencing legitimate trauma.
Mm.
And trauma is whatever trauma is for you.
Yes.
And so one child can go through their parents being divorced and be fine.
Mm-hmm.
They just have two homes with
mm-hmm.
two bedrooms.
Mm-hmm.
Another child experiences that differently
mm-hmm.
and may have behaviors that automatically they are put into the box of there must be ADHD.
Yeah.
Must be depression. Here comes the medication.
Mm-hmm.
And I think what we have to do is be careful because children evolve. Children grow up in the same way that they're losing their baby teeth.
Mm-hmm.
Their personalities are being formed.
Yeah.
Their minds are being formed. And to give a child, to medicate a natural response,
mm-hmm.
a typical response to any life event,
any trauma,
in my opinion, is dangerous.
Okay. So let's backtrack a little bit. Because within our community, especially, we have supposedly everybody keeps saying there are a lot of single mothers, single households, single parent households, and how this affects our men and women, our male and female children. So you see that where, hey, that is a trauma to a lot of people, not having a two parent household. Can you speak about that? Because you just mentioned you could have kids grow up in the same household, one is perfectly fine, that they're fine with the way things are. Mom is the breadwinner and all that. But you may have a different child, again, same household, but they're having the behavioral issues. They're having the outbursts. So what would you advise parents who may be dealing with this themselves right now? What would be your advice to them?
I'm really hard on two groups of people, mm-hmm. parents and faith-based communities.
Please.
When it comes to parents, the deal.
I love it.
When you have a child, mm-hmm. whether or not you are ready to be a parent, mm-hmm. you are a parent.
End of story.
And that's it. Mm-hmm. And so your goal, your assignment, your job is to ensure that you're raising a well-adjusted person. Mm-hmm. That's your job.
Okay.
Again, children can grow up in the same household. One experiences the divorce or the abuse mm-hmm. completely different mm-hmm. from another. And I think, you know, one word that I really get away from and hate using is the term normal, yeah. because there is no normal.
Yeah.
Normal is whatever it is for that person. So when it comes to trauma, when it comes to children, and especially in, you know, all communities, yeah. Black, every community, mm-hmm. we've got to look at, you know, I shared a couple years ago, how do you deal with PTSD for mm-hmm. an entire race of people? Mm-hmm. And I was referencing the Black community. Mm-hmm. And the reality is that post-traumatic stress disorder is a term used to define the experiences and the feelings and the thoughts after something has ended. Mm-hmm. So after war, after rape, after a car crash. For many people in the Black community, traumas are still happening.
Thank you. So have you ever heard of Dr. Joy DeGruy?
I have not.
She has a book. And it's called post-traumatic slave syndrome mm-hmm. because everybody thinks slavery ended. And so, you know, we should just get over it. That's what a lot of people think, like, oh, you know, but Black people or melanated people, you want to call yourself Asiatic, you want to call yourself the original. We are still traumatized by that situation, by that time frame. And this goes across the globe because those in the Caribbean who went through the Haitian Revolution or who went through, you know, the Puerto Ricans, you know, we got the, why am I blanking on the Puerto Ricans right now? My friend, she's going to be on here one time. She's Puerto Rican. We're going to talk about the fact that, you know, they have their own history of that. You know, you have the Africans who went through colonization. You could talk about Leopold. You could talk about so much stuff that happened across the globe. And everybody, again, not one-sided, has not realized that everybody's been experiencing trauma globally yes. within our melanated community.
Absolutely.
And we are still dealing with those traumas till this very day.
And, you know, when we get into ethnicity, sometimes people turn their ears off. Mm. So let me explain it in this way. For the clients that I've worked with who were combat veterans, mm-hmm. they leave the war zone, but fireworks, mm-hmm. police sirens, mm-hmm. a car backfiring.
Still sets them off.
For a woman that may have been raped, mm-hmm. the certain smell, the cologne,
yeah.
the body type, yeah. those are things that can still set them off.
Oh, yes.
I mean, it's just
it's a sense.
It's in our society. And I think, you know, there's not enough conversation around what trauma is, mm-hmm. how it looks, mm-hmm. and how we're supposed to support people dealing with it.
Okay.
Conversations like this, I love.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, as women, we talk about everything. You know, I'll be like, okay, AB, tell me about the new guy that you're dating. Tell me, you know, how's
there is
the job?
New guy, by the way, there
okay.
is no new guy. I don't want anybody on here just like, oh, what's she talking about? No, there's no new guy. Please don't do that to me.
But we talk about mingling. Everything, and yeah. we're comfortable even before
yes.
we're talking about, you know, birthdays
everything,
and everything.
Yeah.
Why is it not commonplace for me to say, how are you doing? Or mm-hmm. I noticed this,
mm-hmm.
or you seem stressed,
mm-hmm.
or even, do you think you might need to get your medication mm-hmm. tweaked a little bit?
Mm-hmm.
Why are we not having those conversations?
And I said that, because we had this conversation in the car, I said that I've been really blessed to have true friends that we do have completely all these conversations. I was just talking to a friend of mine last night, and literally we were on the phone till midnight, and we're talking about trauma. We're talking about, hey, I'm dealing with stuff from mommy issues, daddy issues, and this might be why I'm in certain relationships or not in certain relationships. You know, certain things are very generational. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? And that could be traumatizing. It is not to the point that, hey, somebody's depressed or somebody has anxiety or stuff, but it may still lead them to certain actions are just predisposed from your generational issues. What your parents dealt with, to what they dealt with, to what you are now dealing with. So now how do we break that cycle? You know, breaking those curses, you know, and certain things is not always mental health. It's how do we have those emotional conversations to allow us to heal? Because we are in a state of trauma, and I want us so bad, my people, I want us to heal from all those things. And so speaking to people like you who are dealing with the mental health specifically and are saying that, hey, it's not always a mental health thing. It's just the fact that you're dealing with trauma and you weren't coached or guided in how to deal with those responses.
That's it. I tell people all the time, we do not medicate human emotion. Mm-hmm. If someone close to you dies, you are a human.
Yeah.
I expect you to experience sadness.
Yeah.
If you're not experiencing any sadness, I might be concerned. I tell people it usually takes one full calendar year for you to just deal with all of the foundational issues.
Mm-hmm.
That's going through every birthday, driving by the favorite restaurant, mm-hmm. going through every holiday. Now, if you're grieving in year 7, the same way that you grieved on day 1, now we're talking about a mental health concern.
Yeah.
Not saying mental illness, because they're two different things.
It's concerns, because you could have a break. Everybody has a moment to just, like, some people can literally lose a parent.
Mm-hmm.
And they coped with it very well all those years. And it may be something literally 10 plus years down the line, and they're triggered.
Absolutely.
And I was just talking to another friend today, my nail tech. I be having my sessions with her. Like, literally, I'm so blessed with the kind of people I've been surrounded by and who have surrounded me, right? To the point that it was just about, hey, you dealt with something and you didn't know how to deal with it. You were triggered by this and this just set you off. Because I've really worked. I'm an Aries. We're both Aries. I've worked on my responses, trying not to be fire in that negative space. Because fire can be very healing.
Absolutely.
Fire can be very healing, very soothing, all those things, but it can be very dangerous if let loose. And the ego of an Aries can be brutal. And I'm Nigerian too, so if y'all know some Nigerians, we could be cocky. We could be everything. And I've worked on all those, you know, different elements of myself. I really had to break myself down to work on all that stuff. And certain times, if certain things are real specific for me that trigger me, and as I try to avoid those things, and then one day I was just triggered so hard that I flipped out on a friend. And it was like, you know what? I'm not apologizing. Because this was a trigger for me. And it was like, I kind of told you I had this thing. And I kind of was trying to avoid it. And you just kept pushing at it. And then when I went off.
Well, you know, what you're talking about is emotional intelligence.
Mm-hmm.
And this is why it's so important that we throw away the word normal.
Mm.
And every person creates the wellness plan that works for them. Mm. Emotional intelligence, there are 5 tenets. The first is self-awareness. You need to be aware of you. Every person, whether you have a mental health diagnosis or not, you need to be aware of you, aware of your triggers, aware of what sets you off, aware of times of the month, the year, the whatever.
The moon cycle.
You need to be aware of that. You do. And self-awareness first then allows you to self-regulate, which means, I know for me, there's certain times of the week, the month, the year, that being around other people just isn't for me. That's working not. From a Panera Bread isn't going to work. Mm-hmm. I need to be at home because I have to protect my energy, my spirit, my me.
Yes.
And then when you understand self-awareness and you're working with self-regulation, then you're a self-advocate. Then I can tell my friends and I can tell people, you know what, this isn't a good time for me to hang out. Let's do it next week or let's do it tomorrow. And, you know, within mental health, we get so, it's a conversation that people are afraid to talk about. I've had men tell me that they rather have a conversation with me about their prostate exam than to talk about mental health. And here's why, and I understand it, but here's why. It's because every man has to do that.
Yeah.
Every man doesn't experience depression or anxiety or fear of being around their children or their wife or their girlfriend based on what they've experienced. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, stigma is part of why I share my story, part of why I speak openly, because someone needs to see that sometimes a person experiencing a mental health challenge may look like me.
Looks identical to me.
The World Health Organization actually states that 1 in 4 people are going to experience a mental crisis in their lifetime. Mm-hmm. 1 in 4. We need one more person in this room, and okay, I'll be the 1 in 4. But you know what? It might be 4 out of 4.
All right. Yes. So we are going to take our first break.
Okay.
If anybody wants to call in to speak to Natasha or I, it's 813-444-9588. We'll be right back on God is Talk. Thank you.
Hey, this is Agent Wright, better known as Mr. Clean. You looking for some great barbecue? Come see Them Two Brothers in the Grill, located at 423 Virginia Street, Charleston, West Virginia. We got ribs, chicken, pulled pork, brisket, collard greens, mac and cheese, baby. Come get some.
And get you a nice, smooth cigar.
304-550-4431. That is 304-550-4431. Come get some, baby. The Rib Man, mama, the Rib Man.
All right, welcome back to Goddess Talk. Our special guest is Miss Natasha Pierre, who is a licensed mental health specialist. I'm just gonna put, because you have so many certifications.
Whatever, hodgepodge it together.
You have so many certifications or certificates. The African just came out of me. certain words still trigger me, where I still say it with a little twang. But we left off. You were talking about self-awareness. That's the first step. And then self-regulation. And you said that those are the two things that you really truly focus on in the work that you do. And what are the other steps? Because you said there's 7 steps?
There's 5 of them, but those are the first two. Empathy goes into it. But we've got to understand that, you know, when we speak about mental health, there's still considerable stigma when it comes to mental health. Mm-hmm. So people feel comfortable speaking about cancer, prostates, lupus, whatever. But when it comes to mental health, that's when we voice and we've got to whisper about it. We can't speak.
It's a stigma, especially
there is stigma. And so really any person that is, if you have a mental health diagnosis, self-awareness and self-regulation are non-negotiables for you. You've got to be a great self-advocate. And then you also have to have a role in educating the community. Everyone, you know, you walk down the street, everyone has an idea of what cancer is, and what it does. Everyone knows what the flu is, the cold. Do people know what anxiety is? Only what they've seen in movies, unless they've been personally affected or they know someone. Do they know what autism is? Well, isn't that when, like, a person can't, like, have eye contact? No, it's not.
Because then we could talk about Asperger's and all these things. Okay, so let me just drop what I have a knowledge of.
Yes.
I've been working in the field of developmental disabilities since 2010. And I own a company in Jersey where we work with individuals with disabilities, right? So we do their case management and all those things. So I myself have, I'm qualified to have the conversation with you. And I dislike and despise a lot of movies that depict what my so-called client will look like. And it's like, I tell my employees, look, you may read their assessment, and guess what? You meet this person, they are not like that. Or you may read the assessment and think that they're not like something, and then guess what? You meet this person who is out of control. But the thing is to understand that, have the experience with the person to make a judgment call. You see what
Absolutely.
I'm saying? And it comes with training, because I train people on takedowns, which we called personal control techniques. They may call it something else in Florida, right. But up north we call it, it's been a minute since I did the training. But I was the one who was training on those things. So I know how to take somebody down who's 6-something, who came charging at me.
Mm-hmm.
I train people on how to do that. But guess what? What triggered him to
Absolutely.
To do that, you know? And so when you backtrack and realize that, hey, somebody said something slick to him, somebody did not want him to have a specific reward that he was supposed to get. You know, somebody, you know, another individual screamed across the room and that just set him off. Or guess what? He came into program or whatever in a bad mood. So there are certain things that you may not realize in your immediate environment that could trigger somebody.
You know, it really, I don't even have any politically correct way of saying it. It blows my mind mm-hmm. how much people can have tunnel vision. Mm-hmm. I remember a case that I had. You know, the child was acting out in school, mm-hmm. fighting, not doing work. Okay, the only place that he behaved was on the football field. I was like, okay, let me figure out what's going on. Well, the child was living with a family member. I think it was an uncle. Mm-hmm. And my first question was, okay, where's his mother? Mm-hmm. Where's his father? And so I think the mother was in a treatment facility. The father was in prison, living with a family member. So my next question was, okay, have you all had the conversation with him about where his parents are? No?
No.
Okay. Now, when I speak with the child, he's telling me that he's acting out. He doesn't want to be in class because he's being teased mm-hmm. about not having parents.
Kids are rude and mean and just... Oh my God. So this whole bullying thing really pisses me off, because I was bullied. I'm tall, okay? But it was always a thing because I dealt with the racist part of bullying, mm-hmm. right? Where, yeah, I was tall and I was being called, because my family came here when I was 7 years old from Nigeria. And we moved to a town. I grew up in Willowboro, but that was after we moved out and came back into Willowboro. But I lived in a space, in this place called Hightstown, East Windsor, New Jersey, right? And it was like, it was hell for me, but my sister flourished in that area, right? And I dealt with some things there where it was just like being bullied, and it's just like, look, I could really knock your block off, but then it's like, I'm telling the teachers, or I'm telling the people that, hey, this is what's happening to me, and they're not believing me because I'm this tall black chick, you know? Or the fact that, hey, if I do now aggress towards a person, it must have been me. But it's like, hold up, the person pulled my book bag or did this or said something. Oh, you know, your accent, you know, we all know the African booty scratcher jokes, you know, all those things. And I dealt with that, not just from white folk, but from our folk too. And it was like, at times, it was like, I wanted to not exist in this space anymore, you know? And a lot of people think, okay, well, you're suicidal. It's like, that's not the case. It's just that if you go home and tell your parents, who are also foreigners, but foreigners are what? They're working. They're coming home. They're checking home. Everything's fine. So what's the problem? You know, and not saying nothing, like my parents didn't do what they're supposed to do. It's just that you can't always blame the parents when they may not know how to coach a child through that, because they're not in that space. And at that time, we're talking about in the early 90s.
Yes, right.
2000s now, you have ways to do this with your children. At that time, that's not what they were thinking about. You know, my parents may call the school teacher and tell them, oh, this is what's happened to my daughter. What do you want to do? Back then, they weren't doing anything. They weren't suspending like they suspend like crazy now. You know, there wasn't all those counselors to work a child through that stuff at that time with me. You know, so I'm now in my 30s, and it's like I have dealt with those things on my own. And when I see these young kids who are going through the same stuff, and you have kids now committing suicide, you have kids now aggressing to the point of true violence, guns, everything, knives. We had that in the UK where the knifing is crazy over there. You know, bombs and stuff like that. And it's just like, where do we truly help and assist these children to heal with whatever it is going on inside, that they don't have to do that and literally ruin their lives and others as well?
This is really a community conversation. Hmm. And years and generations ago, we really had an oral tradition where families communicated. Yeah. This is why it's so important for parents to be educated about mental health. I am a huge proponent of mental health first aid certification. I think if you have a child, if you are around a child, if you know a child, mm-hmm. it is your responsibility to get that training. Again, I am hard on parents. I'm hard on parents because I work with your kids. Mm-hmm. And I know how many conversations are going unhad.
Yeah.
And I know that, here's the thing, we want to think that everything can be done in a school setting. It's not happening.
No.
Teachers are overworked, underpaid, the classrooms are getting larger, and they have to teach to a test
yeah.
in the public school system. So there's a lot of things that they're just not going to be able
Absolutely.
To address.
Absolutely.
And parents, you are your child's first parent, first counselor, first trainer, first advocate, first mentor, first everything.
First love.
After
everything.
You handle your business, mm-hmm. that's when the community comes in, the mentors, etc. How are we going to fix this? How are we going to support our children? Personally, I believe that, and it's hard to say, but I'm going to say it. There's a lot of talk mm-hmm. about what are we going to do and how can we fix it? And 19 million meetings and 42 conference calls and 22,000 emails to plan something. No, how about you talk to a child? I just finished a self-advocacy training 2 weeks ago. 9 boys. Great conversation. In the room, 9 children, 9 young men, 2 were personally affected by suicide. One with a girlfriend, mm-hmm. an attempt, and one who had someone that actually completed. Mm-hmm. Question, they said, why aren't they talking to us about stuff like this? I felt so hopeless with my friend.
Because
and so
you do have those friends.
You do.
You think that you just being a friend is enough, but guess what? They may need more than you as their friend. They may need more than you as their mom, their dad, their advocate, their all that stuff, because it does, like you said, that community. Because a lot of people who have dealt with these suicidal thoughts, they feel literally alone. Okay, they feel like there is nobody who understands how I'm feeling. There's nobody who understands what's going on in my head. There's nobody who knows what's going on in my heart, my soul, all this stuff. And I just choose not to exist anymore. And
can we say that this is not a character flaw?
There's nothing wrong with feeling like this.
This
now,
is
how,
not a character
how
flaw.
How can we have that conversation without somebody judging? Because it's, now you want to talk about, well, just pray about it. It ain't no daggone prayer. It is not prayer. It is not. It's not that.
I'm gonna finish this interview. But if you want to raise my hackles, respond to me about mental health mm-hmm. with just pray about it. Build your faith. Fast and pray.
Go back to church.
Focus on the things that are good and lovely and all of that stuff. It's not working.
Mm-hmm.
You know how I know? Because people are dying in pews.
Yeah.
People are dying. People who attend church regularly are choosing to opt out of this earth.
Mm-hmm.
So, yes, we would love to create a world where everyone is comfortable and enjoy being here. But mm-hmm. that's a long-range goal.
That's a utopia.
That's utopia. So in the interim, how about we not invalidate a person's experience? Mm-hmm. Yes. Someone can get in a car. I know people who've been in like 5 car crashes mm-hmm. and they're like, okay, no biggie. I just had my first one this year and I needed to speak to a trauma-informed care therapist. I needed that.
Yeah.
And so everyone has an experience. Everyone has their truth. And when it comes to suicide, suicidal thoughts, being suicidal,
mm-hmm.
the reason why we are so uncomfortable with that discussion is because we're afraid.
Mm-hmm.
We're afraid to have the crucial conversation. We're afraid to say the wrong thing. We're afraid that if we talk about it, then maybe they'll want to do it. Just like that was the argument for sex years ago, that if we talk about it, then, you know, kids will go and do it.
And guess now what? All these kids literally have STDs, STIs like crazy. These kids have no understanding of their bodies, how the body works, what they should do or should not do, how to clean themselves before and after, even if they are participating in it, what kind of things to protect themselves from. You know what I'm saying? Like, they don't even know what that little bump on that person's lip, what that might be. You know what I'm saying? This person may be having a gonorrhea attack. You don't even know.
There's so many missing conversations.
And there are missing conversations. But you just said something, and I'm going to go back to something also. The conversation. and the fear that basically they may do it, right? Because a lot of parents are scared that if they do, they're going to lose their child, okay, in some way, shape, or form. But sometimes we've realized that, guess what? What happens after the attempt or the actual execution of it? That now the regret of, he tried to talk to me, she tried to speak to me, and I just didn't want to listen. I tried to take him to be baptized, and I tried to, you know, get them the medications. Ativan is only going to do but so much, okay? Ritalin is only going to do but so much, because now Ritalin is for, what, ADHD, apparently. But guess what? What happens with that? Have you ever...
suicidal thoughts, yeah, or taking ADHD pills.
Yeah.
And I haven't... I don't...
That was not your experience.
No, because I don't take ADHD pills because my doctor doesn't recommend it.
I love your doctor, because guess what? How many of us go through where doctors are the ones who are like, literally, well, he's having all these behaviors. Well, you could give him this.
Well, let's back up and recognize where we live.
Yeah,
this is a country that is driven by, you know, capitalism, yeah, the pharmaceutical industry. And this is why when I work with my clients, I tell them, you have got to create the wellness plan that works for you. I told someone recently, I don't care if when you hold on to a lizard, mm-hmm, and you look into the lizard's eyes, you feel connected to God and it makes you feel at, mm-hmm, peace. Hold on to your lizard.
Yeah. So we'll be right back, guys. All right, Goddess Talk with Balaji and our special guest, Natasha Pierre. All right, call us if you have any questions or comments. Thanks. Bye.
Hold on to your lizard. Hold on to your
Hey, this is Dr. V, and you're listening to In Touch Radio, reality radio where everyone's a star. Don't you move.
My name is Gil Sampson. I didn't come from a very rich family, and so paying for college would have been very tough. I don't know if I would have been able to go to the college that I went to, and then I don't know if I would have gotten into the career that I am in. So I think Bright Futures has done a lot to shape my life. Got a job as a structural engineer, and I design residential buildings, commercial buildings all over the United States. Because of Bright Futures, I was able to go to college. You know, so many kids just don't even ever get that opportunity. And to be able to do it and not have any debt when I graduated is amazing. And it was all thanks to Bright Futures.
Florida has created more than 1 million jobs in only 5 years, and a great education connects our students to these exciting opportunities. That's why the Florida Lottery has funded Bright Futures Scholarships to help over 725,000 students attend college. Because every play is for education. The Florida Lottery. Just imagine.
Hi, this is Dale Day. Join me every Monday at 7 p.m. for Jazz at Miss Connie's House, bringing you the smoothest jazz and the coolest guests right here on In Touch Radio.
Yo. All right, it's there.
Welcome back. Welcome back to Goddess Talk, all right, with our special guest, Miss Natasha Pierre. With all the certificates that are needed to assist someone in, I believe, let's say, healing. All
actually, right? You know what? The certifications that I got my life coaching. I was life coaching before I was life coaching.
Okay.
Career coaching, yeah, before I got the all certification. The data. I did that for the people who needed that me to be legitimate.
I had a conversation.
That's
with
the only reason why
like
I did
that,
it.
Because he's been doing a whole bunch of stuff for years. And I was like, at the end of the day, you need to get a certificate, because you could keep talking, you could keep wanting to get booked and stuff. But if you don't have that comma, whatever, people are going to overlook you. And that's for them. But you know what the work you've been doing. You know what I'm saying? But, you know, he did get it. And apparently he's been doing great things. But those certificates are for other people.
They're not for people
not
who
for
are
actually doing the work.
They're not for the people who my clients don't care,
yeah,
that I have a life coaching certification or that I. The only thing that I'd say that is a huge a credential that I enjoy is my work incentives planning credential, mm-hmm, which allows me to write plans for people who receive Social Security benefits mm-hmm. because many people are afraid to get back to work mm-hmm. because they think they'll lose either their cash or health benefit. And yeah. so that's a credential that I love that I'm using. But all of the other ones, that and then the WRAP, mm-hmm. Wellness Recovery Action Plan. I love those too. Everything else is for the people who are not living with this every day. Yeah. Who like, well, what makes you qualified to speak about mental health? How about lived experience?
Yeah. But that's not even a qualification to them either, because guess what? They do overlook those who actually have the disabilities, supposed disabilities, you know, because again, a diagnosis is not, that does not determine who you are as a person. You know what I'm saying? I have people who aren't diagnosed, but they're straight a-holes, plain and simple. But then I have clients who maybe have disabilities and they're the most caring people in the world. They will give you the shirt off their back and everything. So it's like, honestly, it's who you are as a person that should dictate how people treat you, not your diagnosis, you know? But you said something also, but I want to go back to impulse control. Because a lot of us, so-called normal, which I know you say that's not a word. It's not, because... But impulse control, we lack impulse control ourselves, but swear that it's only those who are diagnosed that possibly lack that? What? They're not the ones. Look at TV these days. Everybody fighting and throwing beer bottles and stuff. What kind of impulse control is that?
You know what? Impulse control is let's just break it down. Your whatever you have going on in your world, mm-hmm. diagnosis or not, death or not, I don't care what it is, that's not a license to affect someone else's peace, period. I tell clients all the time, I don't care what your diagnosis is. I really don't. I care about your ability, not your disability. Yes. And just because you have a disability doesn't mean the world revolves around you.
Yeah.
So when we're talking about mental health, I really don't care what trauma you've been through. That's mm-hmm. not the issue. When it comes to how you're going to interact and engage with other people, we share this planet. And so you can't do anything that's going to affect my peace, and I won't do anything to affect your peace. Yeah. Now, when we're talking about impulse control, that goes back to self-regulation. For many people who have a mood disorder, let's just say everyone, mm-hmm. because whether you're diagnosed or not,
you still have
I see it at work.
Every disorder has a mood.
Yes, everyone has a mood disorder, and even people who do not have a diagnosis or who may be walking around undiagnosed. Everyone has attitudes and moods and they don't feel like dealing with people, and I get it. And so self-regulation means when you didn't get your second cup of coffee or when you're having a low energy day mm-hmm. or when you spilled something on your shirt or you broke something, you dropped your phone, whatever it is, that's your stuff. Mm-hmm. You got to handle it. And when we're talking about a wellness plans, it's counseling, it's therapy, it's journaling, it's writing, it's crystals, it's spiritual baths, it's manicures and pedicures, it's Reiki, it's massages, it's whatever you need to do to ensure that you are safeguarding and maintaining your mental health. That's not, you're not responsible for my mental health. Esteban, you're not responsible for
only
mine.
Yourself is responsible.
I'm responsible for me. And so if that means sometimes I say no, if that means sometimes I quit,
I disappear.
If it means sometimes I disappear, if it means sometimes I'm working from home instead of out of Panera or mm-hmm. the office, yeah. if it means that I have to cancel something, my mental health is more important, and it's going to sound harsh, but I'm going to say it. Your mental health is more important than someone's feelings.
Okay, so we were having a conversation about this earlier, and it took me a long time to get to this. And my friend today, she's my Leo. We really get some real conversations between the two of us. And she was like, you have allowed people to kind of just leech off of you. Mm-hmm. She's like, you've allowed them to leech off of your energy, good energy, finances and everything else, right? And I had a couple things happen within the past year where it's just, I just needed space from everybody. Like, period. And I was unapologetic about it. And I refused to apologize for it because I was like, I need my space. And by the time I finally came to try to talk about it, it wasn't received. Again, I'm not going to say that the person should have received me better. That's not the case because they're going through their stuff. That ain't got nothing to do with me.
Right.
But what I said was that, hey, I was going through something and it had nothing to do with you. And so that doesn't mean that I don't want to be a friend or any of this stuff. It's just literally I was going through something. I felt some type of way, and this is what it is. I've gone through it. I'm fine now, but I'm ready to move forward. Mm-hmm. It didn't seem like they were, and so that's just how things ended. So now that's happened in a lot of, you know, sexual partner relationships as well, because, hey, people disappear at times. You know, a lot of people don't know how to cope with certain things, and when emotions are part of it, depending on who it is and how you've adjusted in life or not adjusted, you may have to ghost people. And we shouldn't always take it as a bad thing when someone goes ghost, because they may be going through something that they have not even been able to fathom, to even comprehend, to speak about. And it's just like, you need to give them that space without you thinking it's about you. They fell off on you. Oh, they not really down with you. That's not it. They may just need their space. Release people. Release them. Because if you have that expectation people are always going to be forever, you're going to be hurting. And I hurt for a long time because of thinking forever and having those expectations.
So there's a lot going on.
Okay.
There.
Uh-huh.
First, I'm going to start with the individual, with the you, with the me, mm-hmm. with you, Esteban.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Self-awareness. Self-awareness. Self-regulation. Mm-hmm. I'm going to throw in two other selves, because this is what I work with high school students on. Mm-hmm. Self-determination and self-advocacy. Self-determination is you have a choice. Mm-hmm. You have a right to make choices based on what you deem is best for you. That's your choice just by being a human, simply because you exist. Mm-hmm. The other part of that is self-advocacy. That's when you tell people how to help you. That's mm-hmm. when you communicate and speak mm-hmm. your choice. Mm-hmm. And so I've ghosted people before. Mm-hmm. Some, you know, just went away, and that's okay. Mm-hmm. But I will always recall I had a friend who, during the initial stages of my diagnoses, would text me every single day mm-hmm. because the relationship meant that much to her. Mm-hmm. It wasn't a tech. It wasn't a test. I wasn't testing her. But she just knew something's going on with Natasha, mm-hmm. and I'm going to let her know every day that I'm there for her. Mm-hmm. So how do I deal with it now? At the times when I need to disappear, I'm grateful that I have wonderful friends around me that I can say, hey, need some space, I'm need some time, gone for a minute, mm-hmm. I'll be back. For the ones who are unable to handle that and who internalize it. And here's the reality. Sometimes it's a person's own insecurity with themselves that compel them to want to force you to explain and to articulate what you are not yet able to articulate to yourself. Mm-hmm. And here's for everyone that's watching. Here's the reality. When it comes to mental health, because there's so much stigma, because no one's talking about it, the people who are experiencing anxiety, depression, suicidal thoughts, paranoia, delusions, etc., they don't know what's going on with themselves. And so before they can articulate and explain to you, they've got to be able to explain it to themselves. So can you give them some space? Can you give them some grace, some peace? Just say, you know what? I'm here for when you need me. I'm not going away. Mm-hmm. And the way that I deal with it now is I believe in reason, season, lifetime. Mm-hmm. And I adhere to that. So if you are unable mm-hmm. to stand with me mm-hmm. during my tough season, it's okay. I release you in love.
Look,
I release you in love.
Release in love, meaning that I don't have any drama with anybody. I don't have any malice towards anybody. I literally am still living my life and still speaking of people so highly, even after the fact, that they may not speak about me, but it's like, I don't have a problem. But it's releasing in love.
I release
you. And releasing, that was the biggest test and lesson and most beautiful experience to finally find that release in myself. Because it's very hard, because we want what we want.
True.
Especially Aries, we want what we want when we want it. But it's like, you know what? This isn't happening, and I release you. I love you, but I release you. I release you from the pain that you may feel with me. I release you from my presence. I release you from my energy. And there's nothing wrong with that.
Nothing wrong with that.
There's nothing wrong with
any of that. And so with the conversation about mental health, let's talk about some things that can mirror a mental illness, mm-hmm. but really are you need to clean up your personal life. Forgiveness, mm-hmm. rage, anger, resentment, disappointment, having people around you that are parasitic and leeching off of you, relationships that are not mutually beneficial, mm-hmm. all of that stress. Yeah. and frustration mm-hmm. can look like, appear like mm-hmm. a mental illness, but all you need to do is just block some people on social media.
Yeah, and delete unfollow, the negative people in your life.
That's
as
it.
Well.
Yeah. Just get rid of them and you will be amazed. There are some I'm at the place right now, thankfully, because my mental health is my responsibility. I unfriend and I block and I release and I do it with, I don't owe anyone an explanation because my mental health is more important than your feelings. And if I'm supposed to reconnect with someone in the future, then God will see that it is so. But for this season, you are not the person that I can have around me.
And there's nothing wrong with that because people will feel like, oh, they're owed an explanation. They're this. It's like nobody owes anybody anything. That was the biggest lesson I learned. I owe nobody anything and they owe me nothing in return. So if I operate from that space, I can move within my life literally unapologetic of being happy, having peace. Having peace is the biggest thing out of all this when it comes to mental health or dealing with traumas or anything. Everybody is seeking peace
Absolutely.
And happiness.
Absolutely.
You know? But we will be right back. If you want to call us, 844-813-444-9588. This is In Touch News. It's Goddess Talk. Talk to you soon.
You've come to the right place. In Touch Radio. In Touch Radio. In Touch Radio.
Hey, this is Miss K with K's Kitchen, where we're cooking Chicago-style fried chicken and fish with the authentic Chicago-style mild sauce. Come check us out at our new restaurant located at 3320 East Osborne Avenue in the Jackson Heights area. We have a brand new menu, which includes whole wings, catfish, pizza puffs, and much more. Call us at 813-368-5196. Again, that number is 813-368-5196. See you soon.
Hi, I'm Donald L. Dowers Jr., your motivational guru. This is the DLD Motivational Moment. One darn second. America, since 2017, is suffering from a serious hiccup. 9/11 is seriously overused in a distasteful manner. Every day, the cops are calling on an innocent person of color. It amazes me that America has come down to this. A person of color becomes a person of interest. Waffle House, the dorm, Starbucks is a few. This is not the lunch counters, sit-ins of the 1960s. 2019, harassed simply for being black and proud. Hold on one darn second. This has been the DLD Motivational Moment. Pre-order my new book, Motivational Moments, at DLD282002@yahoo.com or 813-394-5875.
Hey, it's Goddess Talk. We are back with Natasha Pierre. We're talking mental health and just a lot of different things that go with spirituality, even just dealing with our own selves, you know, being self-aware about issues we're going through, having that self-regulation, impulse control, self-determination, self-advocacy. And I think this last part of our segment, let's talk about medicating, because a lot of us see that a lot of our children are being over-medicated at a very young age for things that are human responses to certain situations, all right? A lot of our adults, I work with the adult population of developmental disabilities, and they're being overly medicated because nobody wants to deal with the behavior. They don't. Nobody wants to see them crying or see them, you know, bouncing off the walls, where if we could figure out the other things around them that could help bring them peace and, you know, solidify their grounding, I feel that's like a ground chakra situation right there, they wouldn't need to be medicated so hard. So let's talk about medication. We know we are in this country. It's a pharmaceutical country, okay? But what's your thoughts on the whole medicating?
Well, as of today, August 1st, 2019, 7:40, 49 p.m., there is no medicine that can erase your memory. So if you have experienced a trauma, if you've experienced any pain, you're going to have to process that and go through it. I'm not anti-medication. I think that sometimes medication is necessary, especially psych medicine. Yeah. However, it is not suitable as a long-term fix. Mm-hmm. For anyone, especially with mood disorders, dealing with anxiety, you're going to have to process some of what are your triggers. You're going to have to understand you, and you're going to have a wellness plan that supports you in the way that you need. Mine, I talk about a mental health toolkit. You know, the toolkit in your trunk, you've got a wrench, a hammer, a screwdriver, some nails. Mm-hmm. You've got Fix-It-Fly. You got a couple things just in case. Your trunk, yeah. And that's how it has to be with your mental health. Mm-hmm. You may need manicures, some puppies, some kittens.
You need self-medication.
You need self-care. Yeah. You need to do that. Self-eating. And part of that, therapy and coaching. Listen, if you've been through any, especially trauma, if you've been through trauma, you're going to have to talk it out.
Yeah, whether talk to your friends.
Friends, but you know, family. Sometimes you need a clinician. You need someone who is trained to help walk you through that. But medication, I've tell people, we do not medicate sadness. We do not use medication as let me just take a B12 shot. That's not what medication is. Medication, in my opinion, is when your symptoms are interrupting and disrupting daily functioning.
Yeah.
So if it's anxiety attack and you're unable to leave home and get to work, yes, that's a situation where medication can be used. If you are sad, that's not a medication situation.
It's not. Some people self-medicate with things like drugs, alcohol.
Gambling, shopping.
Yeah, we know those to be regular things that, you know.
Acceptable.
Acceptable, because that's normal. That's what society has built up to be the thing that we all do. Everybody's popping X and doing all this stuff, and it's like, that's not the case. You know, but medicating, I've seen the physical detriment to your body, because those things take a toll on your body, on your health. If you're on medications for a long time, you could have kidney failure. Y'all listen to these commercials. Hey, have you taken these things and have you experienced this? Oh, you could be, you could be part of a lawsuit about the situation, you know, but the pharmaceutical companies are protected by the government because you can't sue them directly for things that the doctors are being paid to kind of give you at the same time.
With medication, for me, in 2013, I had acute kidney failure, and I am 100% certain that it was linked to the medicine that I was taking at the time. Mm-hmm. Some psych medicine can make you suicidal.
Very.
Homicidal.
It says it.
It is. Those are the side effects that's not included in the commercial. So parents, when you think that you're just giving your child just something to help them focus, we do not medicate being a child.
Yeah.
That's not a mental illness. Being a child, you know, a 6-year-old boy will jump on things. A 10-year-old boy will want to play. We do not give a child medication because you need some alone time.
Yeah. So we're going to stop there because I want you to be able to promote yourself. So talk about, do you have any books to share?
Yes. I published my first book last February. It's called Provoking Thoughts, which is also the name of my Monday night show. Okay. Provoking Thoughts, 101 Inspirational Quotes for Daily Living. Mm-hmm. And that's available on Amazon. Mm-hmm. What I'm really, really proud of is coming up on September 22nd, I'll be part of a live show in Orlando for This Is My Brave. Mm-hmm. This Is My Brave is, it's more than a movement now. There's a documentary. You can find it on YouTube. But I'm going to be part of, I think, 14 or 15 member cast, and we're going to be sharing our stories and our experiences with mental health, with mental health diagnoses. Really, really excited about it. Mm-hmm. It's going to be my first time publicly sharing my full diagnoses, and I'm excited about it. Again, people need to see that sometimes a person who might be experiencing a mental health crisis might look like me, might look like you, might look like any of us. And so I'm excited about that, and I'm transitioning, and every so often I have to do that. So I'm moving away from some of the things I've been doing over the last year and 3 years. I want to work a little bit more directly with clients. So stay tuned. I may have some slots opening for new clients.
So if they were to try to get to become a client of yours, what is the information that you can provide at this time for them to either take a phone number down or find you on the website? Give them your information.
Absolutely. So if you're watching me on Facebook, or you see this on Facebook, connect with me on Facebook, either Facebook.com Simply Natasha or Facebook.com Natasha Pierre Official. I'm also on Instagram, Natasha Pierre Official. You can find me on Twitter. That's my name, IERRE. Uh-huh. Connect with me there, and the website is natashapierre.com. This is what I do every day, all day. I talk about mental health, so I'm happy. Yeah. Thank you for having
thank
me.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
This was a great experience for me because we were talking about so much other stuff. Mm-hmm. Like, I want you back after, especially after the show. So how can they see the show? What is it going to be on Netflix, or where is it going to be?
So
on?
We're doing the live show September 22nd. In Orlando, and I'll post the link to my Facebook page. Okay. But just look up This Is My Brave. Go to events. You can purchase tickets there. I believe it's $20. Mm-hmm. We have 300 seats, and people are getting them. So if you want it, get it now. Yeah. And then after, I'm sure it's going to be released on the website and on YouTube. So even if you're not in the Orlando area, you'll still be able to see it.
And we'll definitely watch it. And then if I can find some tickets, or, you know, September what?
September 22nd.
September 22nd. Oh, 922. That's going to be the 7th year anniversary for my company in Jersey.
Really? Then you have to be there.
I have to be there. That's going to be a celebration. Okay, so thank you so much for coming. Is there anything else that you would like to let people know about you? Well, you're from the Caribbean. She's from St. Thomas, y'all. So she could tell y'all where to go in St. Thomas to have a great time. I've been there before. Yeah. You have just such a beautiful energy. You're also a Reiki practitioner.
I am.
All right. So the next show, we're going to have you on here. We're going to talk about all these things, the spiritual side, not just the mental health. So again, this is Goddess Talk. If you guys have any questions, drop it in the comments. We're going to talk about everything else. I could, you know, respond in comments about any issues you have. Is there anybody you want to give a shout out to?
Ooh, my core tribe, to Catherine, my best friend, to Shanique, to Shina. Okay. Those three have been with me for years, and those are my go-to, my ride or die. I also have a...
You have a lot of people.
Yes.
All right. So let's say this. This has been Goddess Talk. If you have any questions for us, if you want to be a sponsor on Goddess Talk, you can hit us at info@goddesstalkcast.com. You could go on our website, which is goddesstalkcast.com, if you want to be a sponsor, a vendor, all those things. But we will see you next week. We have another special guest next week. But looking forward to seeing you all. This is Balaji with Goddess Talk. Y'all have a beautiful evening. All right. Mwah.